Okay. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Good afternoon or good morning, depending on the place and your time zone. It's a great pleasure to be invited, and it's an honor to give a presentation at this meeting. Of course, I am it's a sad story that we have to go online instead of a true physical meeting. But it's nice to see my colleagues at least on Zoom, and I'll do my best to present to you our results, our recent results on the way how we do ab initio calculations to determine thermal properties. The work was done in collaboration with Alena Ponomareva, Maxim Belov, Ekaterina Smirnova, Kostya Karavayev, Kirill Sednov, Babur Mohamedov, and with our chair, Alexander Kwan. And it's a collaboration between my university in Sweden, Linköping University, and National University of Science and Technology, Mises. I would like to acknowledge my colleagues, just trying to move my slides, yeah. I'd like to acknowledge my colleagues who also contributed to the results, which I'm going to present and to show today. Members of my group at Linköping University, Davide Sangamani, Johan Klanberg, Bjorn Aling, Sergei Simak, Davide Gambina, Uli Hellman, and Nina Shlumba. My presentation is devoted to several subjects. I will give a little introduction, short introduction on first principle simulations, basically focusing on simulation of solution phases. I can save some time due to the excellent presentation by previous speaker. I will also show some examples, talk about theoretical description of thermodynamic and mechanical properties of multi-component body-centered cubic iron chromium-based alloys. I'll show how theoretical calculations can be suitable for understanding diffusion, and in particular, I'll present superionic-like mass transport in BCC titanium. I will focus on model techniques which have been developed in Linköping for simulations at finite temperature, the temperature-dependent effective potential method. And I will give the last story is about mixing enthalpies of alloys with dynamical instability, because this subject I consider is of very high importance for thermodynamic community. I hope I have time to conclude. Let me start with a graph or the picture which many of you have already seen many times, because we are talking systematically about multiscale approach for materials modeling. There we start with quantum mechanical simulations at relatively small system sizes. Then to go to larger system sizes, we have to coarse grain our system, we have to get rid of electrons. So we go to thermodynamic models, and then we go to higher level models, finally ending up in doing simulations for our target object, like, for example, a nuclear reactor of the next generation. The idea is, of course, that we can, at all these steps, parameters needs to be presented, and then in very many cases the parameters are taken from the blue sky. They sometimes available experimentally, but it's very often that experimental information is limited, is not complete. What I am going to argue that theoretical calculations can be used to get these parameters, and this can be done with density functional theory. I said that many of you have seen this picture several times before, and we are talking about a multiscale approach for 4 years. Given this time, the approach should be actually already working at the engineering, not just research level, and it still doesn't. And one reason why we have challenges in going all the way from quantum mechanical calculations to device simulations is the fact that we are using parameters which are most often calculated at zero temperature. I'm very happy to see in the previous talk that people start to include temperature effects at present, and this is very important. And for me, this is a key to get proper parameters for high-level models. One should do simulations at low-level models at the conditions where parameters are going to apply. It is a little bit meaningless to calculate zero temperature elastic constants of a material and use it in simulations of the property and the performance of the materials at 1000 degrees Celsius. The main part of my presentation will be devoted to illustrating this issue and to describing what tools we are using and what tools we have developed and how these simulations can be carried out now. Still, I start with something very, very simple. The basic idea behind the density functional theory. We know that all materials consist of atoms. Atoms consist of atoms and electrons. Electrons are moving on roughly spherical orbits around the atoms. When atoms form solid, the inner electrons feel very little, but the outermost electrons can leave their respective atoms and they form bonds which keep atoms together. Now we have to remember that electrons are quantum mechanical objects. They are neither particles nor waves, they are both. And the proper parameter, the proper value to characterize the behavior of electrons is electron wave function, which is not observable. The observable quantity is electron density. And this is the basic of density functional theory. But knowing the electron density, you can predict and determine all other properties of the materials, like lattice parameters, mixing enthalpies, the properties which are relevant for the subject of the present talk. And of course, density functional theory was formulated in the 60s, in 64, 65. First papers were published by Hohenberg, Kohn, and Shem. The equation which we solve is roughly presented in this graph. It looks very much like Schrodinger equation, but electrons are moving in an effective potential created by a nucleus and all other electrons. In the theory, and it's very important to understand, the density functional theory, they say, which is a theory, which is fully proved on the basis of two theorems. There are, of course, approximations in practical applications of this theory. And the three circles of approximations are related to the way how the one electron potential is defined, how the equation is actually solved, because our computers don't like differential equations, so we have to expand our wave functions in a Bessel set, and different Bessel sets are used, and this gives rise to a this is an origin of all the zoo of electronic structure codes available now. But in addition to electrons, we do have atoms, we do have nucleus. And though density functional theory transforms a multi-electron unsolvable problem to a one-electron problem, the amount of nucleus are still there. And for the mole of your material, there are 10 power about 24 nucleus. So strictly speaking, you still do have 10 by 24 power variables in your equation to solve. And this is what I will refer in the remainder of this talk as a structural complexity. And this is what we have to address to make our problem solvable. Before I move to this issue, I would just like to underline another important point, that density functional theory is a constantly developing theory. It is a theory which is alive. It is a theory which always improves basic approximation, especially in terms of the one electron potential. So the previous speaker focused a lot on the development of a scan functional. There are also other approximations like dynamical mean field theory, LDA plus U, hybrid functionals, which allow us to produce data with higher and higher accuracy. But as I said, today I am going to focus on the structural complexity. So I'm going to talk about this circle of approximation, how it deals with many atoms in our system. And originally, the theory was considered and developed for the case of ordered compounds. So when we have a perfect periodic order between, say, red and blue atoms in this particular case, if we do have this periodic order, we can define the unit cell, and then we can make Fourier transform and remove the rest of the crystal and solve our problem for the unit cell. And this is very, very important, because the solution of differential equations, which we transform to linear algebra, expanding our wave function to the basis set, scales as an n cube with a number of atoms in the unit cell. Basically, for two atoms in the unit cell, it takes 8 times longer to solve the problem than for one atom in the unit cell. And that's why it's getting pretty much complicated to treat complex systems. Okay, so these are ordered compounds, but we do know that, and especially in thermodynamic community, the solution phases are obviously very important. And in this case, we cannot define a unit cell because the periodic distribution of atoms is broken. Translational symmetry is broken. There are two techniques which are currently used to address the problems in the solution phases. The first one is a supercell method, where you take a system as large as possible, introduce periodic boundary condition, and solve your problem for the big, big, big unit cell, which we call supercell. Of course, it is very important to understand that you cannot have an ad hoc distribution of atom, or you better don't have ad hoc distribution of atom in your supercell. There are very intelligent techniques like special quasi-random structure methods suggested by Alex Unger in the 90s. So you can design the supercells intelligently, so you don't have to average between different supercells, but you have answer from calculating your properties just for one supercell. Still, calculations are extremely time consuming because you have to treat large number of atoms. And as we have already pointed out before, the computational effort scale as n cubed. There is an additional method or alternative method for treating the solution phases, which is called Cogan potential approximation. The idea of this method is to, instead of doing supercell, to find an effective atom. Basically, you substitute your disordered distribution of atoms by an ordered distribution of effective atoms, which the properties of which should determine or describe the properties of your original solid solution components on the average. You have to find the proper quantity which you have to average. Now I'm moving from red and blue to yellow and blue. I'm considering a solid solution, AB solid solution. And when I introduce my effective atoms, my green atoms, and I solve very well-proven, mathematically proven equations in terms of the so-called Green's functions. But the physical meaning of these equations is very simple. You assume that you add one A component in this effective medium. Say, if you consider equiatomic alloy, you add one A component, you add one B component, and on the average, the system of these A and B impurities in your effective medium should give you the same properties as your effective medium. Of course, if it's not a non-equiatomic alloy, you have to weight it with concentration. So this is the basic idea behind the technique. So both supercell technique and Cogan potential approximations have advantages and disadvantages. Supercell technique is very accurate. It can be realized with basically every electronic structure code available now on the market. Cogan potential approximation requires special programming and has additional problems. For example, you cannot treat the problem of lattice relaxation. So at this point, atoms are sitting at the ideal position, which may be a severe limitation. However, it is very, very fast. And I'll show the application of these methodologies first in understanding the effect of multi-component alloying with different impurities on the properties of iron-chromium alloys. The example of iron chromium alloys is very interesting because this is a base for many important industrial steels, and in particular for nuclear reactors. It is known that steels with up to 10% of chromium show enormous stability, very high resistance to irradiation, to swelling, and other very important properties. However, for the next generation nuclear reactors, we need, which are supposed to operate at more extreme conditions, you have to ensure that that your alloys have better properties. And one way of going and designing new steels is multi-component alloy. Obviously, experimental studies of iron chromium alloys with multi-component additions is very complicated and time-consuming thing. So we hope to be able to assist this type of development with electronic structure calculation. My first result shows, my first result graph here shows iron chromium alloys and the comparison between different methods. So here I would like to compare my supercell technique with my effective medium or CPA technique to show that both of them can be applied in the present case. The very different properties have been calculated, lattice parameters, mixing enthalpies, bulk modulus, single crystal elastic constant, Young modulus, Shear modulus, and for example, G over B ratio. The blue diamonds show results of supercell calculations carried out with WASP software. Red and black symbols show the results of the CPA calculations in different approximations. And the green triangles show the available experimental data, which we were able to find to compare our results for experiment. To save time, I just say that in principle, different techniques lead the results with quite sufficient accuracy to perform characterization of this material. In particular, using the frozen core approximation most often give better results with, in comparison to experiments. So in the remaining of this talk, I'll show CPA results obtained in a frozen core approximation. Another thing which you have to have in mind to compare theoretically calculated results, especially for magnetic alloys with experimental information, is that you have to treat magnetism properly. Indeed, consider a ferromagnetic material at zero temperature. In this case, all magnetic moments are pointed parallel to each other, so you have perfect ferromagnetic order. However, when you start to increase the temperature, this ferromagnetic order is destroyed. The magnetic moments do not disappear, they do not shrink. What is actually shrinking is the net magnetization. However, the local magnetic moments in most systems remain well-defined at even above the transition temperature, the Curie temperature in this particular case. We are dealing with system with well-defined local moments, just pointing out in all different directions. And to simulate this kind of system is a non-trivial task. One model which has been developed for this type of simulation is the so-called disordered local moment model, where instead of two-component alloy iron chromium, one considers a four-component alloy, iron spin up, iron spin down, chromium spin up, chromium spin down. And in this way, you really model the paramagnetic situation in iron chromium alloys. So we have disordered local moments pointing out in all possible directions, and it is possible to show analytically that though the collinear magnetic moments are considered within disordered local moment at very high temperature, the collinear and non-collinear picture for pointing moments up and down or pointing moments in all possible directions should give you the same result. So let's now compare, oh, it's in Russian, thermodynamic properties of iron chromium alloys with experiment. And experiment is taken at very high temperature. So this is an experiment from Dench, which you can find in Haldane handbook. So if you compare your ferromagnetic calculations with this calculation, with this experiment by Dench, you would see very, very poor agreement. However, if you compare the calculated and experimental results in at appropriate condition, basically experiments were taken in a paramagnetic phase at high temperature, which we model, as I said, with disorder at local moment, you see very good agreement between theoretical and experimental calculated results for the mixing entropy, which is a K quantity for the thermodynamic analysis. On the other hand, when you go to the low temperature ferromagnetic phase, you see that the mixing enthalpy in iron-rich system is actually negative, explaining the anomalous stability of iron-chromium alloys up to 10%, which are used in practical applications. So this stability of iron-chromium alloys in ferromagnetic phase is very important for us. And that's what we are going to look at, how this behavior is affected by multi-component alloy. So let's start to add additional elements to iron chromium. This we can done both in the supercell, but this is actually a cartoon. The actual calculations are done in the framework of the Cochran potential approximation. Green line in this graph shows our base alloy, so BCC iron chromium alloys. And when we start to add nickel, which is one of the most promising elements as considered to improve mechanical properties of iron chromium alloys in the generation 4 reactors. But we see that addition of nickel is actually somewhat unfavorable. It destabilizes alloys, the minimum moves towards high, lower chromium concentration. And if you add in a manganese and molybdenum towards nickel, you may have the alloys which are not going to be thermodynamically stable formally, at least at zero temperature. So this minimum just disappears. Another very interesting quantity which we can look at and characterize is the tendency towards the spinodal decomposition, because very often people consider just mixing enthalpy, but of course we have an additional information. If we take second derivative of the mixing enthalpy, we can look at the tendency towards the spinodal decomposition, and we can also see that nickel increases tendency towards the spinodal decomposition. So basically, you can alloy less chromium before the system would should start to decompose spinodal. Because nickel is quite favorable, what happens if we add more elements? And this is true advantage of ab initio calculation. So you can really add a lot and obtain these results within the very reasonable framework of several months. So you can really, really test a lot of different materials or different alloying elements to see how they would affect your mixing enthalpy. Of course, this can be done not with supercell, but only with CPA calculations. As I have shown you before, they are in very good agreement with each other. And I really don't want to spend a lot of time on looking at this very busy graph with different alloying elements. I hope that in the nearest future, these results will be available for public. What I just would like to underline is that we do see that nickel, the nickel alloys are here marked with kind of a lot of blue lines. It really destabilizes our system, so it makes our mixing enthalpy more positive. But the element which turns out to show increase the stability of solid solutions is aluminum. And I have to warn, I understand that there are people who understand and work with real materials. I didn't look at competing phases in these particular simulations. Mixing enthalpy was calculated only with respect to pure alloy components, and we considered only BCC alloys. It was a lot. But what we see is that while nickel removes these minima, which was characteristic for iron chromium and characterized its stability, aluminum actually makes it makes the mixing enthalpy more negative with respect to pure alloy components. But you can look at more than just mixing enthalpy. Ab initio calculations allow you to predict and to consider also elastic properties of this material. You can calculate single crystal elastic constants. And from that you can get mechanical properties of your polycrystalline materials, like the key parameters for engineering applications, Young modulus and Shear modulus. And the behavior of Young's modulus and Shear modulus due to the multi-component alloying is actually very similar. Nickel somewhat reduces both Young modulus and Shear modulus. Aluminum increases both Young modulus and Shear modulus. It doesn't compensate completely the effect of nickel, so if you alloy them together. But at least the part of the decrease, and decrease is not very high, can be compensated by aluminum if you add it to iron, chromium, and nickel. Even more interesting is the possibilities to estimate relevant mechanical properties which cannot be calculated. Of course, such relevant properties like brittleness or ductility can not be determined completely consistently from ab initio simulation at this moment. But you may use phenomenological parameters like a typical G over B ratio or Cauchy pressure. So if you consider the ratio of Shear modulus to bulk modulus and it's below 0.5, you can expect your material to be ductile. And the same, if your Cauchy pressure is positive, you also can expect your material is ductile. If G over B ratio is more than 0.5 or Cauchy pressure is negative, you can expect the brittle property for your material. And once again, most of the effect is determined by chromium, of course, but if we look at aluminum, it actually should make the material more brittle. Nickel makes it more ductile. And once again, the combination of alloying element, nickel and aluminum, they kind of balance the element, make at least the solid solution with respect to pure components even more stable without strongly affecting mechanical properties of the material. So this type of conclusions you can derive from ab initio calculation considering a lot of simulations and a lot of materials with very reasonable computation efforts. Now let me move to the final temperature effect, because so far I was talking about still zero temperature calculations, and I fully agree with the previous speaker, with Alexander, that you really have to go to final temperature simulations to get reliable theoretical data and the reliable properties for your material. I will be very quick in this graph, because Alexander in the previous talk very excellently introduced the way how one can induce temperature effects using harmonic or quasi-harmonic approximation. You basically calculate your phonon dispersion relation, which here I show for the case of the new high pressure phases of boron, gamma boron. We can you can obtain your frequencies for your lattice vibration, phonon density of states, calculate vibration for free energy, and calculate all your properties as a function of temperature. For example, volume, elastic modulus, pressure derivative of B prime, et cetera, et cetera. And you can see that, in particular in light elements, this can be very important. Even a small temperature of 300 Kelvin can sufficiently affect the calculated properties. The issue is that this type of approach cannot be routinely done on all kinds of phases, because if you take BCC titanium and try to do this type of simulations, like quasi-harmonic approximation simulations, you see that your frequencies at certain K vectors are getting imaginary. This means that your material is absolutely unstable, dynamically unstable, if you have the imaginary frequencies at a general K point, or mechanically unstable if you have the imaginary frequencies at gamma point. This would be also seen in calculations of elastic constants. And if you have imaginary frequency, you basically cannot determine vibrational entropies in your conventional harmonic or quasi-harmonic approximation. The approach which allows you to do it, because we all know that BCC titanium perfectly exists. You just have to heat your titanium to about 1,100 Kelvin, 1,130, don't remember exactly. And your material is going to be perfectly stable. So the approach and the way to treat and to simulate these materials is, of course, ab initio molecular dynamics. And that's what you can really see. So if you do zero temperature calculations for BCC titanium, you actually see that your system starts to deteriorate. BCC phase is unstable, but already at 900 Kelvin, so below the BCC to HCP phase transition, your atoms are going to vibrate around perfect BCC positions. So you get mechanically stable material, and I will show in a few slides how you can calculate it. You can calculate form and dispersion relations at 1300 Kelvin. They are going to be in perfect agreement with what was measured for BCC titanium. There are additional properties which can be derived from molecular dynamics because it really allows us to see what is happening in your material. Because your atoms are vibrate, and if you follow yellow eye, you see that red atoms have just jumped. So you can actually look at diffusion in your materials. So not only to calculate ground state properties, but you really have a lot of interesting features. And sometimes you get the results which are quite unexpected. So let's consider again our BCC titanium at temperature which is very close to the melting temperature and carry out our molecular dynamic simulations in the defect-free unit cell. So I underline, so now you are going to see what is happening in your defect-free unit cell. So this is the results of our initial simulation, so no vacancy. We all know that the vacancy mechanism, you see what is happening. You see that atoms start to move. So it's a concerted motion of several atoms in a defect-free unit cell, which provides you a new mechanism for the diffusion in titanium. And if you want to do classical simulations at larger systems, so you see that this concerted motion of atoms without any vacancy are very much existing and very much not seldom. You can go and you can calculate your diffusion coefficients. And in agreement with experiment, you see upswing and deviation of your diffusion coefficient from the Arrhenius behavior. So we argue that the new mechanism, which has been just shown to you, which was obtained in molecular dynamics simulations, really contributes to anomalous behavior of diffusion in BCC titanium at high temperature. I have more proof for that. But I would like to move further to our subject presented for in this study. One challenge with ab initio molecular dynamics is that it is not so easy to derive a free energy. You can do it. You can calculate autocorrelation function, but basically this is very difficult to do in ab initio simulations because of limited time and limited size of the supercell. So several years ago, Uli Hellman and our group has suggested a new method how to calculate free energies from ab initio molecular dynamics, which is called temperature-dependent effective potential method. The idea is that you define your model Hamiltonian, very similar to your usual quasi-harmonic approximation, but you determine your force constants not from calculations and simulations at zero temperature, but from simulations which are based on ab initio molecular dynamics. So basically, do the force matching method, where forces from molecular dynamics and displacement from molecular dynamics should be matched with each other for this model Hamiltonian, finding the proper coefficients corresponding to the force matrix. You can use all kinds of symmetry. And then your force constants, effective force constants, which are now going to be temperature dependent, and where really are determined. So here we show another example, BCC zirconium. So red line corresponds to the force constants, which would be calculated by Fonepi, by your traditional method of choice. And they would lead to imaginary frequencies in your Fonepi dispersion relations. But if you do this force matching for molecular dynamics simulation at 1300 Kelvin, your force constants do change, they become much more short range, and your Fonepi dispersion relations all become pretty much real. And with these real Fonepi dispersion relations, you can use all your machinery, calculate vibrational free energy, and calculate the free energy using the clever trick, determine the potential energy from your molecular dynamic simulation. So your free energy is perfectly well defined. And the method has been used for many systems for BC silicium, zirconium, titanium, et cetera, et cetera, and shows very good agreement with experiment in terms of determined form and dispersion relations. The free energies allow you to calculate phase diagrams, and the accuracy can be illustrated here by calculating the phase diagram of titanium. So this is this is a BCC HCP zirconium case, where calculated line for alpha beta transition is very well reproduced in simulation. This is another phase diagram for aluminum nitride. Again, very good comparison with experiment. And there are truly interesting cases where the inclusion of unharmonic lattice vibration leads to dramatic effects in simulations of your phase diagram. These are the results which we obtained several years ago for titanium aluminum nitride, an imported hard coating material, which we calculated first in 2007, neglecting lattice vibrations, which gave a phase diagram shown here in this dashed line. And the closing of this diagram of immiscibility gap, occurs at about 8,000 Kelvin, so totally unrealistic. If you do simulations which now include lattice vibrations with a temperature-dependent effective potential method, you obtain the phase diagram, which is much more reasonable with the closure of immiscibility gap at about 2,800 Kelvin. And though it's very difficult to compare these results with experiment, using atom prompt tomography, we were able to show that the phase diagram obtained in 2016, which includes the unharmonic effects of lattice vibration, is much, much more reasonable in comparison to both experiment, but of course the original phase diagram from 2007 is totally wrong. This is an important example which shows the dramatic effect for systems which could have been calculated otherwise. My last subject for this presentation deals with mixing enthalpies for alloys with dynamical instabilities, which otherwise would not be possible to calculate at all. And I would like to consider titanium vanadium alloys, BCC titanium vanadium alloys. So you have HCP solid solution, BCC solid at low temperature, very relatively low solubility, so vanadium and titanium, but still non-zero. BCC alloys, complete solid solubility at high temperature, and a large miscibility gap, where you have an equilibrium between BCC and HCP solid solution. And we do already know from what I have shown before, but dynamical instability of BCC titanium is very important, at least to describe the BCC titanium itself. Obviously, one can expect similar effects and very big importance for the description of the phase equilibria in an alloy. I will start with a relatively simple case. I'm not going to present and calculate phase diagram now, but I'm going to talk about mixing enthalpy. And once again, I truly appreciate the presentation by Alex, who presented the conventional way of how we do calculations and how we calculate mixing enthalpies in different system formation energies. The conventional approach is to take your system, your oxide, your ordered compound, or your solid solution phase simulated with a supercell. Do calculations at zero temperature, relaxing all the atoms in your unit cell. So this is a green line, which is shown in this graph. So conventional calculations which are done in this conventional scheme. So first, optimize internal position in your unit cell, then calculate the total energy and calculate mixing enthalpy from this total energy. So the green line behavior is like that, and you really should suspect that something wrong is here, because mixing enthalpy should not behave like that. Actually, if you do CPA calculations for unrelaxed supercell, you obtain this black or red line. So once again, SQS technique, supercell technique, and effective medium technique agree very well with each other. So all this effect comes from the fact that you have lattice relaxations in the BCC. And you do have this lattice, local lattice relaxation, but they are totally crazy. So this is a snapshot of your relaxed supercell, but if you do just this conventional scheme, you take your supercell, you put say one vanadium impurity for simplicity, you relax your atom, so that's what your standard software would do for you. But you see that atoms, titanium atoms, are not going to be where they would be in your BCC structure. They just start to move, they just start to do anything they could to get out of BCC, because your BCC phase is dynamically unstable. It really corresponds to the position of the ball on the top of the hill. You touch it, your ball starts to fall down. This is exactly what is happening in your simulation. So the results which you obtain at zero temperature, this green line, it doesn't, well, you have to think what you obtain. So this point is definitely not BCC from my point of view. Your system tries to modify, tries to become omega phase. It is restricted by your supercell size, so it's not fully omega, but it's definitely not a BCC. And consequently, I view and I think that this green line is meaningless and has no physical meaning. Okay, if we now do molecular dynamics and do simulations at 1300 Kelvin, we see that the running average of your stresses shows that the system becomes dynamically stable, and you also see that your BCC titanium atom start to vibrate around their positions, their equilibrium positions. So this is BCC titanium vanadium alloy as it should be at 1300 Kelvin. So the mixing enthalpy of this system has physical meaning. It is correct. It is reasonable. And this is what I show in this graph by the blue line. And I truly appreciate the collaborations with Sandy, who took courage of making a measurement for this system. Of course, we were unable to find mixing enthalpies for titanium vanadium alloys. We see that the mixing enthalpy measured experimentally at 1100 Kelvin. So the difference may be partly related to the fact that measurements and experimental calculations are not done at the same temperature, but it's definitely positive. We definitely don't have and don't see this negative dip here. And agreement between ab initio simulations and experiment is really very, very good. And just to show what you would expect but now shown with respect to HCP titanium. So this is basically, my internet connection is unstable. I hope you still hear me. So this is language doesn't have physical meaning, but in the area where alloys are dynamically stable, zero temperature and AMD results are in very good agreement with each other. So when you are dealing with dynamically stable system, things are okay. If you go to a dynamically unstable system, you have to be very, very careful with your interpretation of the simulation of ab initio results. And my advice is to go to high temperature ab initio molecular dynamic simulations. Okay, let me conclude my presentation by summarizing and saying that simulations of material properties using methods of theoretical physics are highly relevant for fundamental science, as well as for applications, and that novel methodologies extend capabilities of first principle calculations. Simulations can and should be carried out at realistic conditions, and collaboration between theory and experiment is essential for future, for verifying results and for future progress. Thank you very much for your attention. If you have any questions, my emails are shown.
Thank you, Igor. The questions are now welcomed. And actually, I have one already appeared from Professor Andy Watson. There was a slide, I think, on enthalpies of mixing and an iron chromium system. And there was a note that you compare with some PM measurement range. So what is PM?
PM is paramagnetic. So the measurements were done at very high temperature. I don't remember now, it was about 1000 degrees Celsius. So definitely above the magnetic phase transition in iron chromium alloys. So the system corresponds to the disordered local moment picture, and consequently it should be compared to theoretical calculations simulated by a system with disordered magnetic moment. So paramagnetic is paramagnetic, and that's very important to understand, because in many fields, the paramagnetic and non-magnetic is considered as to be the same. And what we would like to underline now, that these are two completely different systems. In non-magnetic simulations, you artificially suppress the local magnetic moments. So not only net magnetic moment at this graph, but also all the arrows here would be zero. These would be non-magnetic calculations. They would give totally wrong results. So to get right results, you have to include your local magnetic moment and distribute them randomly. So this is PM, means paramagnetic, and it should be simulated using the disordered local moment picture.
Okay. There is one more question, which comes from Professor Irina Uspenska, and it is, to estimate the stability of phases with close values of Gibbs formation energies, it's important to obtain values with the minimum possible errors. Are there any approaches to reduce the uncertainty of ab initio calculations?
This is not one question. I say that the question is very deep, and it contains several levels. Yes, if you want to describe, say, BCC to FCC transition in iron, gamma to delta transition, as argued and as shown in many cases, for example, in York Norgbauer group, you have to get an accuracy, milli electron volts accuracy. And these are really, really put very high demands on ab initio simulations. People are doing that, in particular in York Norgbauer group, where there is a lot of progress towards achieving this type of accuracy. Accuracy can be achieved numerically, but still you are going to have some underlying issues related to functionals, as correctly pointed out by Alex in the previous talk. It's a lot of work which is done on the improvement of functionals. So we are doing our best to get to this type of accuracies. But it's very difficult to characterize uncertainty of theoretical simulations. This is one of the biggest challenge in our field. Can we give an error bars for ab initio simulations? Sometimes we can, like in ab initio molecular dynamics, but they would be methodological error bars. The error bars due to the limited time in which your MD simulation is performed. It is not going to include errors due to, say, using different approximation for exchange and correlation. So work, it's a lot of work is in progress. To get milli electron volt accuracies to determine gamma to delta phase transition in iron is still challenging. I think determining melting temperature of phase transitions with a 1 Kelvin or sub 1 Kelvin accuracy, which is needed in many cases, it is still challenging. Simultaneously, if we talk about the accuracy of mixing enthalpy measurements or elastic constants, I would argue that theoretical simulations can provide already accuracy very much compatible to experiment.
Okay. No, if that is not the case, we should thank the speaker again.